Blaring Out Show.
This is the Blaring Out with Eric Blair Show, and we're here at Hollywood Forever Cemetery, the first in the series of rock and roll movies. And we're here with Alan Arkush, Clint Howard,
hey,
and Maggie St. Thomas, the fantastic photographer. And let me just say that I watched the DVD today, and I have never heard more exciting commentary than I heard from you.
Oh, you're listening to the commentary?
Yeah.
Good, because I haven't listened back to the commentary. So we ended up cracking each other's up and remembering things that the extras had to pay to be extras.
Yeah.
When that fact came up, we couldn't believe it. And I guess we also told the story. Three groups of audiences heard the same six songs over and over again. And they find when it got too unruly, we said we kicked them out. We brought in another fresh crowd. That was 21 hours of Ramones that day at the Roxy.
The Roxy
was the concert. The Whiskey was the backstage.
Yeah. Boy, what a great time that was to be there at the Roxy. And they would load in these crowds, and then of course they would load us in, the actors in, and then the Ramones were all dialed in and they were playing, and it was really cool. It was really, really cool. And the Whiskey backstage, that was a fun couple of days. I didn't realize that you guys were actually charging the audience. Charging for extras.
Charging for extras.
God, Roger.
I can't.
Roger Corman.
I know.
And Rodney will vouch for this. If you look in the crowd scene, Pat Smear.
Darby Crash.
Darby Crash.
Wendy Melvoin's brother is in mm-hmm. there. I mean, there's so many people who were in other bands or in that audience.
Remember, I announced it on my show for everyone to show up at the Roxy. And they did. I met my girlfriend there, Maria Montoya.
Rodney, you have a couple big parts in the movie. There's a part where you are actually driving this beautiful car right here with the Ramones in it to their show. Let's not forget about the part where you get cocaine blown in your face.
And I brush it off my shoulder. And then I had my Cherie Curry poster stuck up on the wall in the dressing room at the Whiskey A Go-Go, which was supposed to be the Roxy. Uh-huh. Actually, it was supposed to be the Roxy and the Whiskey A Go-Go?
Yeah, it was that, but the exterior was the Mayan.
Just still around today.
Yeah, still around. And we used So It Goes by Nick Lowe to introduce it.
They used to film adult films there.
It's true. We went there to scout it, and we said, all right, this will work great, but we need to see downstairs. No, you can't go downstairs. Why not? Well, you can't go downstairs. We want to go there. They were filming adult films.
Clint, you want to interject there?
It probably didn't cost very much. None of the sets. I mean, all this stuff was really pretty cheap, right? I mean, this movie was done for a remarkably modest price. How many days?
20 days. We shot the movie in 20 days. There was two high schools involved. Van Nuys High School is the stuff you see at the beginning, where they're outside. Most of the exterior stuff was Van Nuys High School at the beginning, and the exterior with a school that blows up and everything, that's another Catholic school. Yeah, it was Watts. And the weirdest thing happened that we were there, and the phone keeps ringing in the principal's office. And we had promised Father Bob that we would not damage anything. So we answer the phone. Hello, who's this? Well, we're not here. We're actually filming a movie here. I says, really? I used to go to that school. Okay, I was looking for my school records. Well, what movie are you filming? It's Rock and Roll High School. Isn't that funny? You know, when I was there, they filmed the movie too. Really? What movie? It's Blackboard Jungle.
Oh, wow.
It was Destiny.
That's a classic.
Destiny.
Yeah. Are you guys excited to see the movie again tonight?
Oh, yeah.
I've never seen it with this many people.
Really?
Yeah.
What did you think when they asked you to do a commentary for the DVD?
I thought it would be fun. That'd be fun. And what really made it fun is the writers came down and we all just sort of went over it, and we're all laughing at the jokes.
Talking over each other.
Yes, and laughing, and it was, so that worked really, really nicely. And also we each wrote essays, and then we adapted the essays after Joey died and after Paul Bartel died. Made it more of a tribute. But it was a nice way to say a lot of stuff about not just the movie, but how much we cared about the people who made the movie together, you know?
Yeah, there becomes a family atmosphere when you spend that much time with people, especially if they're good people.
Yeah, and the movie has had such an effect on people that you feel good about being in it. You know, it's a bonding situation. Right now, if I'm working with someone and they're younger than me, and they figure out, are you in Rock and Roll High School? Their whole attitude changes. Actors, actresses, people I work with, people, you know, executives, like the Suicide Girls, all like...
Oh, yeah. Well, of course.
Yeah.
Rodney, why do you think that the Ramones were one of the most important bands in rock and roll history?
They changed. They brought punk rock to the media, definitely. When I had my very first show, they were my very first guests, and that's when punk took off.
And you were always a big supporter of the Ramones.
Oh, definitely. Right from the beginning. And still, you see people out every day wearing a Ramones t-shirt.
It almost seems more important today to a lot of people than it was back then. Why do you think that is?
Well, because the newer bands, you know, they all look after the Ramones. They look, and all the younger kids, you know, grew up reading about the Ramones and then hearing them, and it's still going. It will never stop.
Now, what do you think of Hollywood Forever? You like this place?
It's pretty, yeah.
Yeah.
Kind of interesting. Yeah.
Now, have you been to the statue before here?
This is actually my first time.
Oh, really?
I'm impressed. Yeah,
yeah,
looks really good. Yeah.
I just saw your movie not too long ago. I really liked it.
Oh, thank
really
you.
Good.
What's sad that, you know, Joey was supposed to be a whole, you know, talking part. He only had a quick cameo in it, but they did have it set up. He was going to do an interview. Mm-hmm. You know, Debbie Harry did one.
Yeah.
And then Joey was set, but he was too ill and couldn't do it.
When was the last time you got to see Joey?
Oh, God. Last time I saw Joey was when he was doing the Drew Barrymore show. And he stopped by my apartment and I gave him a few records and told him about some new bands. He told me about some new bands. And you know, it was the last time I actually saw him was when he did the Drew Gary show.
Now, what are some highlights from your relationship with the Ramones? What are some things that stand out to you that were just like exciting times for you?
Just always, you know. All my stage introductions on stage, introducing the Ramones. You know, Joey's so tall.
Yeah.
I have to pull the mic down. And then being in I was in London one time with the Ramones, which was really cool. I mean, the fans were just berserk for them. It's incredible.
Sonically, those records are still amazing today. I am, like, blown away by when you put on a Ramones record in the car, you could crank that.
Yeah.
Thing. It's got those punchy drums, that bass that just moves you.
Sheena's a punk rocker.
Yeah.
It just goes boom.
Yeah.
It explodes. Explodes to the radio.
You feel it.
Yeah.
Billy Zoom was saying, you know, back in the 70s, you didn't have production like that on records.
Not at all. I remember seeing the Ramones with Phil Spector at the Whiskey A Go-Go, and then he did some of the recordings with them. I was at some of the sessions for End of the Century, which is incredible. I was on Hand Claps and a couple of the songs.
Rodney, I bet you've got stuff put away of the Ramones that people have never heard before.
This is one of the first Ramones t-shirts.
Really?
Very first. It says Sire on the sleeve. And
wow. That's amazing. You kept it in great shape.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
And I bet you have some of their gold and platinum records, right? Well, gold, probably.
Yeah, I have the greatest hits, you know, gold record from the Ramones. It's really cool.
Cool.
And I got a Ramones leather jacket and the little baseball bat and the switchblade knife. And they gave those out as promo items.
Why do you think that rock and roll high school is so important?
Well, everybody always hated high school. And
yeah.
Then get a chance to blow up a high school. It was really something to do. It was really great.
And what were some highlights of working on the movie for you?
Oh, well, the whole thing, being at the Roxy, you know, seeing that concert, meeting my girlfriend, who became my girlfriend at the time, Maria, and just being on that whole scene and being out all the night before with Phil Spector when he's mixing the Ramones Rock and Roll High School.
And what would you say about the Ramones as people? Because you were close to them.
When Joey and I were big telephone partners, we'd always be talking on the phone about, you know, new bands. He was into like Shauna Knife and all these amazing girl bands. And I'd tell him about all the LA bands and he'd tell me about the New York bands. And of course, seeing Dee Dee Ramone at Denny's.
Yeah.
And you know, Marky, seeing him around. And of course, Johnny, who's a big Elvis Presley fan, which I'm an Elvis Presley fan myself.
You have his autograph, that autograph you gave
me. Yeah, there. And I got that driver's license. I got a big collection of Elvis, but I think Johnny's got me beat on that. He's
really
got some amazing stuff because he's good friends with Lisa Marie Presley.
Oh, about the passing of Johnny and Joey.
It was terrible. I remember I devoted my show to the Ramones.
Yeah.
When Joey died, I did a whole Ramones tribute. And then, of course, when Johnny died, I did Ramones. And then, of course, Dee Dee as well.
Yeah.
I remember a while back, while they were still alive, I did a Ramones show of A to Z, all the songs A to Z. From the Ramones.
You know, Dee Dee's death to me was senseless.
And I saw him the night before.
Really?
He was doing a show at a club called Club Makeup. And I just saw him the night before. It was really weird.
Have you seen that movie, the Dee Dee movie, the one where it's just him being interviewed? The whole movie is about him.
I haven't seen that yet.
You should get that. It's pretty intense. It's you know, bare bones. He talks about his life and about this, you know, the time on the street and everything. It's really intense.
Yeah. And he was around. I mean, he used to go to my club, which not too many people knew about, when I had the English disco. And he used to go to Starwood, you know, those clubs back, even before the Ramones.
Now the world will never be the same since the Ramones have come into it, right, Rodney?
Right. Yeah.
And it's the world is a better place.
Yeah. Where's PJ Souls?
I don't know. Is she supposed to be here tonight?
Yeah.
You're a fan of hers too,
yeah,
aren't you?
Yeah. And I play her version of Rock and Roll High School as well.
Have really? You seen the shirts that they have here tonight?
No.
They have Rock and Roll High School. They have the shirts, the Ramones shirts, with the poster of Rock and Roll High School on it. Ooh. Dude, I'm telling you, it's the color. It's just beautiful.
Really? Oh, I gotta get one
of those. It's only $20.
I love t-shirts.
I know, me too. Yeah. I know, I have a hard time like getting rid of them. I save them forever.
Oh, me too.
I have like this, I looked in my closet the other day and it had like an original Paula Abdul shirt in mint condition.
Oh my God, really?
And you know what? I actually have some photographs of you. You probably have these though, of you with John Waite and the babies.
The baby? I sell my baby's t-shirt.
Yeah. So I interviewed John Waite a couple years ago and I used some of those as insert photos.
Yeah, I understand he does some of the babies songs on stage.
Yeah.
Even today.
Yeah, you know what? The Babies were such a great band, Rodney, and they were totally underrated.
I know. I wish they'd get back together.
Well,
I saw Mike Corby in London about 5 years ago. We went out to the, you know, the Rolling Stones have a restaurant called Sticky Fingers.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, well, Bill Wyman owns it. It's really good. And so we went out to dinner. It was me and Mike Corby and Nicky Hopkins. And he looks the same, too.
Really?
Yeah, he really wants to get back in the Babies. And he really loved them.
I think that would do well for John Waite.
Yeah, it would.
But John Waite's a wonderful guy. I've hung out with him before and interviewed him, and he's a gentleman.
Oh, yeah, yeah, he is. Which really shocks people. In fact, I almost blew his image when I had him on my show, was Darby Crash. Ooh. I was spinning records at the Starwood Club, and he was up in the DJ booth. I had my girlfriend there, and he was so polite. He was asking, can I get you a drink, darling? You know, and he got her a drink. It was just a total gentleman. And I mentioned that on the air, and punks got really mad because they wanted him to be real angry and wild. And he's not. He's just a real quiet, nice guy.
Well, the thing is that as far as punk goes, there's a thing called healthy anarchy, you know?
Yeah.
And I mean, you can get through to people without slapping them in the head, right?
Yeah. Let the music clap you in the head.
Yeah, exactly.
And wake you up.
If you're healthy to keep doing the music, then you keep getting your message out there.
Right.
But Rodney, it's great talking to you.
Thank you.
Blaring Out with Eric Blair with Rodney on the Rock.
Bye-bye. Stay true.
The Blaring Out Show.